Welcome to a discussion today of the sick dust hunter. And my name is Bob Mcilvaine. I'm going to be the host, and I've had a lot of admiration for sick, been with them at exhibitions all over the world, and certainly I've known a lot of their people. And the speaker today is going to be Phil Zyskowski, who I've known for a long while. And with him to answer questions is going to be John Chitty, who has a world of experience. And before we get into Phil's bio, let's ask John, if he would, to give us a little bit of his background.
Thanks, Bob. I've been with SICK for nearly 12 years now in various positions in sales. And I'm an application engineer at the current time, and been in the industry for about 39 years, working for end user, Shell Chemical, and then a couple other manufacturers and a rep company. And I look forward to the discussion.
And I think you bring a world of experience here. Obviously, Shell is a huge amount of experience, but even as a rep, my insights, having worked with reps for many, many years myself, is they know the end users and they know the problems, and they're the first one to hear about them from the end user. Isn't that true?
Yes, absolutely.
And then let's move on, Phil, and tell us a little bit about your background, if you would, please.
Sure, thanks, Bob. And it's good to be working with you again. I've got a little bit more tenure than John Chitty, but I've been with SICK since 2003. In the role, again, as a regional account manager, covering the Great Lakes. So we've got a little bit of everything here in the Great Lakes, pharmaceuticals, power plants, chemicals, refineries, cement. It's fun. It's a fun place to be. Basically, I've been a gas analyzer guy for over 40 years, and SICK's given me the opportunity to learn additional technologies like flow and the dust technology and techniques that we're going to be talking about today. In particular, I've taken a role to work with the coal-fired power plant industry in the U.S. and looking for solutions, you know, some of those even beyond our typical flow, dust, and gas, looking at safety applications and material handling and protecting people from equipment or vice versa. Really the innovation of the Dusthunter model that we're going to be talking about today is part of that. And when I'm not doing that, I'm out trying to get out into nature and camping and backpacking and enjoying life.
Well, there's a lot of that in the Midwest as well, but actually there's a lot of coal-fired power plants in the Midwest. Most people read the news and think, you know, coal is disappearing, but there's still more money in the monitoring in coal-fired power plants than there are in any of the other technologies. And it's going to go along around for a long while, I think, that they're going to be around here. So it becomes quite important, isn't it?
And you're right, Bob, particularly in the Midwest, we joke about how, especially in the area of particulate, how some of these plants seem to be actually putting the air out cleaner than they sucked it in. And, just due to regulations that they have to meet and hoops they have to jump through to meet those regulations. So it's, this is a technique and a technology that plays well into that discussion, I think.
Yeah, and so we're looking forward to the presentation here, and I think let's move on to the slideshow and hear about it right from the beginning with the sick dust hunter. So go ahead there, Phil.
All right, thanks, Bob. And we'll try to keep it casual and light. Please interrupt me if you have questions. If you don't mind operating the slide controls for me. The discussion is with a series of analyzers called Dusthunter, and in particular, a new addition to that series, which we've really targeted for tuning precipitators and also broken bags in bag houses. So briefly, This is the agenda. It's always worth mentioning who sick is, and for sure the legacy that we have in the area of dust detection, and then introducing this model SP30. It's a unique design, and just briefly touching on the two target applications. There's obviously more than these two, but just to keep it brief and to you know, make some kind of introduction, we limited it to that. So if you look at our funny sounding name, you mentioned working with us a long time, so you know the story, but maybe some of your clients don't. So this is a family name, Dr. Sick. He was an inventor, innovator, and particularly had a passion for optics. And so founded the company back in the 40s, and is no longer with us, but we're still a privately held company. And you'll see that he's touched a number of industries other than the power industry we're talking about today. Next, please. And one more. So a wide portfolio. And again, a lot of our clients are going to think about us just in the analyzer section. And it's worth noting that we're everywhere. We're scanning the labels of the water bottles that are being packaged that they use daily, luggage tracking, in particular package tracking. People have turned to Amazon and Target and Walmart and FedEx more so during these COVID times than ever before. And all those packages and goods are often read by six sensors and monitored and measured and sensed. So we've got a wide portfolio. Keep that in mind. But today we're going to talk about the analyzers. And I mentioned this innovation or this legacy goes back to the 60s. During that time, a lot of pollution controls were put in worldwide, and in particular in the U.S. We all remember acid rain and some of the images of the destruction that caused. So during that time, SIC was not a global company. A lot of our dust monitors were private labeled with U.S. company names on the outside and the SIC optic bench in the inside. So it wasn't really until the mid-70s that we started to come to our own here in the U.S. In particular, our opacity monitor was standardized on by the U.S. EPA as the technique that the regulations were written on. So if we move down the timeline, down to the far end, to the Dusthunter, you can see this is a new product line and a new platform that was introduced in 2008. In particular, we've had a lot of success. Next, please, with our wet PM sims, the FWE200. And so the SP30 we're talking about today is definitely along those lines of innovation. And I'm going to put a little plug in for a new line of innovation a little bit further down the line. We're also going to be launching a particle size distribution real-time monitor, measure PM10, PM2.5. So look for news and a splash about that sometime later this year or early next year.
So it'll be just the way it's going to be. It's going to be a segmentation for weights by each of the particle sizes. Is that what you're saying?
Yep. In real time, like all of our other analyzers, as in situ as possible, or with some close coupling. But
yeah, that'll be real interesting.
Yeah, you know, as I mentioned before, it's an exciting company to be with. We spend a lot of time and energy in trying to meet the demands of the marketplace and make that investment in people and in resources and R&D dollars. It's good. So the SP30, nothing surprising here, other than I think the two takeaways are for our audience are the scattered light. In this case, we're using forward scatter light as our technology, and the accuracy I think is significant. If you look down to the accuracy statement, it's going to be plus or minus 2% type analyzer, and that's what's going to differentiate us from the benchmark in the industry. Next, please.
And what would be the benchmark in terms of plus or minus?
It depends on which supplier you look at. In particular, I'm looking at a technique, or we're considering the technique of triboelectric, and so it's definitely not a single digit. It could be anywhere from 15 to 20% accuracy, depending on the application, but it's not down there in the low single digits for sure.
And I think that's a very important point to keep in mind as we go along and listen more here. So I did want to get that in as well.
Absolutely. And again, this is just a small sampling of, there's so many details we can get into, Bob, and I don't want to get into that for this discussion today, but just please keep that in the back of your mind that there is a lot of meat to this light scatter technique, and particular forward scatter technique, but sometimes pictures paint a thousand words. So we're trying to illustrate here is we can do measure quite a wide range of dust concentrations, low and high. This makes it ideal for the applications we're discussing today. You can see the different length probes in this picture. We're illustrating a duct that's a different length and a different diameter. What's key here is also the temperature. We can put these in very hot streams, maybe not so much on the baghouse, but on precipitators where the temperature's higher. That's significant. And what makes this fit the market well, we think, is you could see in the upper right, optional parts. So this is a low-cost unit, so you don't need that central control unit. It's an option if you want it. And you don't always need the external purge air unit, so less moving parts. So it's a great way to address the market. Next, please. And you can see here, an introduction into forward light scatter. Not going to have a technical discussion, but just so you understand what it means, what your audience understands what it means. So we're using a laser beam. It's being generated by the, next please. It's being generated in that short measuring path that you see illustrated in the smaller orange square. And then what's going on inside that measuring path is a sender sending the laser beam into the duct, into the dust path. And we're picking up the reflected light with a detector, a simple detector at the other end. And that detector's really only seeing the forward reflected light energy that the laser is sending. And this is not something that Dr. Sick invented. It is a proven technique, however, that's being used in laboratories around the world. It's recognized as a very accurate way to measure low concentrations of dust, in particular if they're different sizes and masses. Next, please. This is really showing the different, I mentioned you don't need the MCU, the control unit, illustrating that on the side of the unit to keep it the cost low and to make it flexible. Next, please. You can see we can have a simple sensor, green light, red light, yellow light, and we're also, if you've got a purge air unit, you can see the LED display for the health check on those components as well. So there is no need for an additional computer and no need for an additional control unit. This can all be seen at the unit, at the stack. And that's one of the breakthroughs for this unit to make it low cost. Next, please. Next. So it's just a quick review. We'll go through this quickly. So it's a standalone design. You can use purge air or not, depending on your application. So this helps us keep the cost down. Next, variety of different I/O. So analog is typical, Modbus is available, and this comes again direct from the monitor itself. In the past, that required an additional box. So this makes it easy for our customers to set it up and to commission it. And I showed you before the different lengths and the mounting options. So no matter what the stack or the duct looks like, we've got a solution for it. And it is configurable, multiple ranges, all in one device. You don't need a separate device for high concentration and low. It's all in there. And then we also provide some preset calibration curves. So there is no need, depending on the accuracy you're looking for, there's no need for a corresponding gravimetric test. Again, trying to keep it simple And this gives our customers some flexibility as their fuel sources vary. Next, please. And so I mentioned the benchmark that we had discussed before. Just a brief next. A technology comparison, and there's so much more we can do on this, but basically, go ahead next, I'm sorry. We introduced the SP30 to meet the market demands that weren't being met by really the standard in the industry for broken bag detection and ESP control and status, and that's a triboelectric. And so they're very similar from the point of view. They're a probe that gets inserted in the stack. I mentioned before we're using forward scatter, whereas the triboflow is actually using their probe to measure the electrostatic or the charges, both impacting the probe and reacting around the probe. And so it's a different technique. There's pluses and minuses to both, and we'll in fairness review those quickly. Next, please. And this is where the payoff is. If you can see the green lines indicated on the charts, these are peaks. And there's a very short time period, you'll notice, that are indicative of what a scatter light analyzer can do. And you'll notice that the triboelectric device in the same installation missed those peaks, missed the intensity of those peaks. And that's where the action is. And again, so we're highly sensitive. We're down low in cost, and it's easy to use both for predictive maintenance and also broken bag detection. Next, please. Next. Yeah, so we've got multiple applications. A little disclaimer, please don't try to apply this for a regulatory measurement. We do, have quite a few offerings for that regulatory regulation measurement that include all the necessary controls and testing that the EPA and other regulatory bodies require. In particular, we're talking about leak detection, baghouse filters today, dosing. A lot of our customers are injecting dust in different types of catalysts and reagents into their ductwork and their stacks. The SP30 would be great for metering that, and also electrostatic precips and cyclones. Next. Just illustrating, this could be a two-hour discussion, where to place a dust monitor, depending on the size of ductwork. It's hard to see in that picture, but you can see a little orange box way at the top of the first vertical stack that we have there. Yeah, you got it. That looks like a typical exit point where we would put something like our SP30 and measure the wrapping sequences, catch excursions that you maybe weren't aware of. Next, please.
Yeah, I think that's an important point because a lot of the emissions from a precipitator do come during the wrapping cycle, don't they?
Yeah, they do, and I don't want to say complacency, Bob, but customers are often surprised when they take a close look at what's going on. They're used to a certain sequence, and that sequence may have been valid at the day that the precip was built, but changes happen. Dust builds up on some of the hardware, and things don't happen the way they always think they should. And so we've had some positive feedback of, oh my gosh, we didn't know that was happening. Good thing we saw that. And usually the corrections are easy to make. It's just identifying and being alerted.
Yeah, so definitely.
It's similar.
Yeah. I was just going to say that's definitely very helpful for, because the wrapping is a critical part of the electrostatic precipitator function.
And yeah, it's a low cost way to check what's going on, and the same thing, and probably more so in fabric filter or baghouse, what's typically called baghouse cleaning. It's more complicated, and there's more things to go wrong there, right? You've got more hardware pieces, and in particular, our customers have indicated they want to know when those bags are broken. They want to know right away. They want to know when they're starting to leak, so that they can take some preventative, you know, steps before there's a disaster. Next, please. So, in general, and in fairness, you know, if you believe, and in case this case, if that's your application, where humidity and velocity of the dust particles in your gas stream are pretty much constant, they don't change, that they always have the same electrostatic charge from day one to day 365, and if you don't need to check the monitor, if you don't need to verify its linearity, then triboelectric will work. And it's a low maintenance item, and it's cheap, and it'll work. However, what the market has told us is they need a measurement that's independent of humidity. And sometimes the electrical charges of the particles change based on reagents and catalysts I talked about earlier. And sometimes velocity changes based on these plants aren't running all full load all the time now, depending on the grid and the demands of the grid. Sometimes they're asked to modify their load, and that would change velocity in some cases, depending on how their plant is set up. And then looking for a way to verify the readings. How accurate is my monitor? Is it doing the same thing today that it was doing yesterday? And so that's how we came to market with the SP30 to meet those demands. Next. So again, very briefly, I thank you for allowing me to give this introduction. It's Six newest entry. Like I said, it's a little bit of a departure. We're going after a low cost solution because the one that's present, the industry is telling us it's falling short. It's not meeting the demands. And for sure, we have more details to prove what we say, and look forward to more discussions like this with you, Bob.
Yeah, I think it's been very, very interesting. And you talk about the low cost, but compared to the cost of not having fairly accurate measurement, you know, bag houses, you can have leaks from broken bags. You can have leaks because of the way they're attached in one thing and another. But the bottom line is, over a period of years, the replacement of bags becomes a very significant portion of operating expense. And
it's not only the cost. It's not only the cost. And I don't want to call it complacency, but I call it the boy that cried wolf syndrome. So often, if you have a technology that gives you a false indication over a period of time when it actually does what it's supposed to do and alerts you, sometimes you say, well, you know what, you were wrong the last three times. I'm not going to believe you this time. And that's really the difference in those two techniques. It's not any particular manufacturer. It's triboelectric. Just it can't do that, and it can't do it quickly. And so that's I think the key is to be quickly alerted when there's pinhole leaks in a bag.
Right, and it may allow you to prepare for a shutdown and not have to shut down and lose any operating time too, if you are better alerted.
And if you believe what it's telling you, right, you say, well, that's not so bad. Yeah, we saw a little bit of a spike, but it's not going to put us out of compliance. Maybe we can wait till the end of the month, or we can wait till that outage at the end of October. For sure, you're right on the money there.
And also, in terms of some of the actual sequences, I mean, you might be pulsing different bag sections, you know, at different times and one thing and another, and having a more accurate measurement of, you know, you'll be able to zero in on maybe where you've got a problem, where you don't have a problem within the bag house itself. Isn't that true?
Yes. I mean, the key to that is you got to try to not sequence the the cleaning cycles. If you can sequence them in order, we've got software that we've used where the customer's actually been able to identify exactly which bag it is. So if you can modify, you know, it depends on what type of bag house you have, but if you can modify the sequence to do it from the furthest away to the closest bag, even if they're in different chambers. This SP30 has got some integrated software where it'll actually identify which bag it is that caused the excursion.
That's interesting because of the different distances that the dust traveling after it leaves the bag, right? I see what you're saying.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah, that's a very interesting twist, but it all gets down to the operations, and there's a lot more money to be saved by better operations than there are a few dollars on the front end for measurement technology. That's for sure.
Yeah, and we know the coal fire guys are looking to save money, especially during these times. So anywhere they can save a little bit of operational cost, you'll find that this type of monitor will pay for itself.
Well, it's been a very interesting discussion, and I'd like to thank both you and John for joining us today, and we'll look forward to having these kind of discussions again.
Good. Well, I thank you for the opportunity. It's been good catching up with you, Bob.